Good evening. Thank you very much, John, and good evening, friends, staff, students and visitors here to Australian Catholic University. Can I join John in welcoming you, and can I particularly acknowledge the presence of Sir James Gobbo here this evening? Tonight is a respectful conversation about marriage, and there are few Australians who've conducted themselves throughout their entire public life, other than Sir James Gobbo, who have engaged in such respectful conversation and dialogue on a whole range of matters, so we're particularly pleased to have him here this evening. Can I also welcome people who are watching tonight's proceedings on the Australian Public Affairs Channel? And can I welcome anybody who hasn't had anything to do with Australian Catholic University before to our campus? Let me say something briefly about the university. Australian Catholic University is the largest Catholic university in the English-speaking world. We've got over 30,000 students. We teach law, business, theology and philosophy, arts, education and health sciences. In fact, we are the largest educator of teachers and nurses in the country. This year is our 25th anniversary celebration, and one of the key things that we wanted to do this year as a Catholic university is to have some public conversations on some issues that are important to our national life. And so tonight's respectful conversation is very much held in that vein. This is the second of two respectful conversations on marriage that we've held. We held one on Monday night in Sydney and this evening in Melbourne. And I think these will be regarded as signature conversations on this topic in our public debate about marriage. We've deliberately chosen to call this a respectful conversation because it is respect for difference that is perhaps lacking in the debate about marriage today. There's a lot of light and heat in this debate, but not enough respect on both sides, too many people playing the person and not the ball. We've deliberately chosen tonight's panellists, a very distinguished group of Australians, people who have deeply held views on the topic of marriage, but people who will address this issue with respect for each other and for those who hold a different view. Just because we're having a respectful conversation doesn't mean we're not going to have a robust exchange and interchange of views. This is a debate. People should have different views, and it's a topic about which reasonable people can disagree. Tonight we have one of the senior bishops of the Archdiocese of Melbourne, Australia's best-known Jesuit priest, the Australian Human Rights Commissioner, and one of our great columnists and political and social commentators. Each of them has a different view on this topic, and we'll hear from them shortly. It's important for Australian Catholic University, as a Catholic university, to provide an opportunity for staff, students and the broader public to engage with the Catholic intellectual tradition and not only to know but to understand some of the Church's teachings. And while the teaching on marriage is well known, it is perhaps not well understood. It's also part of the Catholic intellectual tradition for our university to be a place where dialogue occurs between faith and reason. If we achieve these aims, then we are truly serving our motto, which is truth in love. In a moment, I'll introduce the speakers, and each speaker will speak for about 8 minutes, and don't worry, there's not going to be bells here or anything uncivilised like that. Then we'll have a period of roughly 10 minutes where I'll be asking the questions that have been pre-submitted to us by audience members when they registered. Audience members who are here have also cards on their chairs, and there's a pen as well. We want you to write down questions that you might like me to ask. And what we will do is at the conclusion of the final speaker's speech, I think the final speaker is Miranda Devine, we'll have people who will come and collect the cards if you pass them to the end of the rows, and that way we can get through as many questions as possible in the remaining time. So it's going to be an interesting evening, and it's going to be a lively evening, and we hope it will be one that you'll enjoy. And remember, and we hope at the end of the day everybody will be a little bit better informed on this topic. It's now my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Father Frank Brennan. Father Frank Brennan is a Jesuit priest and he's a professor of law here at Australian Catholic University, as well as holding appointments at the Australian National University, the National Centre for Indigenous Studies. He's on the board of St Vincent's Health Australia and Jesuit Social Services. He's author of numerous books, and the two most recent are a collection of essays on social justice called Amplifying the Still Small Voice, and a book called No Small Change, covering the issue of Indigenous constitutional recognition. Father Frank Brennan was awarded the Officer of the Order of Australia in 1995 for his work with Indigenous people. And in 1998, the National Trust classified him as a national living treasure. In 2009, he chaired the Australian National Human Rights Consultation Committee. He has degrees from the University of Queensland, Melbourne College of Divinity and the University of Melbourne. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in making Father Frank Brennan welcome.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for that gracious welcome, Julian. And I join with you in acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we meet. I have to say I'm feeling rather nostalgic reflecting on marriage today. I've just flown in from Brisbane, which was my hometown. I can celebrate it at the Requiem Mass in St. Stephen's Cathedral this morning of one of the leading old-time Catholic solicitors of the town. I was ordained in that cathedral 30 years ago. It turned out that the gentleman who died, Brian King, he and his wife were married in that cathedral. The presiding priest at the Requiem Mass had performed the weddings of all five children, some of whom were married in that cathedral. My own father had moved the admission of Brian King as a solicitor when he became a lawyer. So you get something of the picture, something of the old-time solidity of the society looking back on that generation. As we came to honour his coffin at the beginning, they not only placed his legal brass plaque, but things like his missal and his rosary beads, he having prayed the rosary every day of his life. There's a whole breed of Catholic solicitors and lawyers that used to exist, which I think Sir James Gobbo would agree with me. We're not quite sure that they're going to exist in the future. We are in a situation of profound change. So when I come to contemplate something like a respectful discussion on marriage, and particularly the topic of same-sex marriage, my starting point is to reflect that within the Catholic tradition, I think we've always had a very good teaching about marriage, but we know that there is a lot of social change which is going on, even amongst people in the pews of the Catholic Church. I've been a priest for 30 years. I don't think it would be any secret nowadays for you to know that most people who come to you, even to be married in the Catholic Church nowadays, they will have been living together before they come to get married. Now, that used to be a different situation when I was first ordained 30 years ago. There has been a lot of social change about the concept of marriage. I think the contours of the church notion of marriage, and in the Catholic Church there's always been a strong sense that marriage is a sacrament, one of the seven sacraments, the only sacrament which is performed not by the priest but by the couple, and the priest is simply a witness to what occurs. It's seen to be a sacramental union of a man and woman who are open to the bearing and nurturing of each other's children. And I dare say it's because of that openness to the bearing and nurturing of children who are to be the foundation stone of the future church. It's for that reason that a robust sacramental theology developed about the institution of marriage. Similarly, in civil terms, I dare to say that if we hadn't instituted civil marriage as of today, I don't think we'd be bothering much about state intervention or state approval of anyone's relationships. But the state obviously had an interest, particularly given that women were so disempowered and there were questions about property allocations between a man and a woman who forged a union of a marriage, but also, most significantly, of course, the situation of children. It was the situation of children that was seen to be absolutely central. Well, all of that, I think, is in flux. And whereas, even in the lifetime of many of us, even in civil terms, a marriage was seen to be something which couldn't be terminated except by a special act of a court, nowadays it can be basically terminated by one of the parties deciding that time is up, and then after a year it's simply certified that the marriage is terminated. So in legal terms, it's a very different relationship from what it used to be. Well, with that background, let's come and consider something of the question of same-sex marriage. We in Australia live in a society which is not dissimilar in many ways from countries like Canada, the United Kingdom, New Zealand, the United States, all of which have now legislated in some way for the recognition of same-sex marriage. And the question has been, well, where do we go with the question here? Part the issue for me has always been determining, well, What's the appropriate body for making such a decision? We are very different from the United States. In the United States, they always expect that in the end, the nine unelected judges will simply hand down like tablets of stone what the answer is on any contested moral social question. And they did that recently with great aplomb, 5-4. And everyone's there to pick up the pieces. I've always been attracted to the idea in Australia that we don't tend to have those sorts of decisions made by unelected judges. We tend to entrust them to our politicians. And marriage in Australia has been a federal issue rather than a state issue, as it has been in the United States. So that's why I've been strongly of the view all along that basically it should be a matter for a free conscience vote for the members of our parliament. I went back at one stage, did some research and found that when the great Sir Garfield Barwick was introducing the original marriage bill in 1960, he negotiated with Gough Whitlam, who was leader of the opposition at the time, that there would be a conscience vote and that it would be a very timely debate. There'd be weeks and months for people to deliberate, for parliamentary committees to do their work, but then ultimately for people to take a conscience vote. Now, I happen to think that's the Australian way of doing these things. So I was a bit upset at the Labor Party when they went to their national conference and some on the left started to play up and say, well, we'll bind people to a fixed vote after a certain period. I knew that that would simply mean they'd be playing up on the other side as well. And in the end, what did we get? But Prime Minister Abbott said we'll have a plebiscite. Now, I'm not in favour of plebiscites for these sorts of things, as I've intimated. I think you have a referendum of the Australian people to change the constitution, but I basically think you entrust a conscience vote to your parliamentarians to have a vote on these things. But given that we're going to have a plebiscite, well, let's have it. I think we should have it sooner rather than later, in that I think that most people have made up their minds. When it comes to the question of what the law ought to be in relation to this issue, I am accepting that Australia, I think, within a fairly short period of time, will go the same way as New Zealand, the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom, and we will have legislation which recognises same-sex marriages. Where I've always urged caution in terms of the timing and in terms of the mode of discussion, and that's why I favoured a conscience vote and not our politicians simply making a vote according to dictated party policy, is that though I think same-sex couples have said to the rest of us for a long time, look, there's nothing to fear because our relationship is really the same as yours, I think there are still quite a number of heterosexual married couples in Australia, particularly older Australians, who say, well, look, I'm not quite sure that your relationship is the same as mine. And so we've got that to deal with. There are then questions, I think, to deal with children. I think children, as always, should be central in these discussions. One of the things which changed, particularly in the United States, which helped to change my view about the need to move ultimately to a legal change, is the large number of children who are now being brought up by same-sex couples. Now, if marriage is an institution which is designed to facilitate the nurturing of children, then I think they are a group who also need to be considered. But one fear I do have, and I'll continue to have this fear, is that I think ultimately same-sex couples with a right to marry legally will in time want all that marriage in the old times used to be, that is the capacity to bear and nurture each other's children. And there's no doubt that the technology will be available in the foreseeable future to use the genetic material just of two men or two women to create a child. Now, I think there are major existential questions there about the children who will be thereby created. And I think that's a discussion that we also need to have respectfully. Now, I know some people say, well, you don't need to have that discussion now, you can have it in the future. I simply say, on these sorts of big issues, let's put all the issues on the table and let's deal with them now as we try as a society to navigate our way forward. So, that's where I come from on the issue of same-sex marriage in civil law. I still say in the church, we've got a lot of work to do in order to educate our young people as to what we understand the sacramentality of marriage to be, whether it's a same-sex couple or a heterosexual couple. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Our next speaker, Tim Wilson, has been Australia's Human Rights Commissioner since February 2014. As Commissioner, he's focused on promoting traditional rights and freedoms, such as the freedom of speech, freedom of association, freedom of religion, and property rights. Tim Wilson also acts as the de facto Commissioner for Sexual Orientation, Gender Identity, and Intersex Status. Prior to his appointment, Tim was a public policy analyst and policy director at the Institute of Public Affairs. He served as a board member of Monash University's Council, Alfred Health, and on the Victorian Board of the Australian Health Practitioners Regulation Agency. Tim has degrees from Monash University and lives with his partner, Ryan, who is also an ACU alumnus. Please welcome Tim Wilson.
Thank you very much, Julian. But I should probably correct my official biography, which is not your error, it's mine. And I live with my fiancé, Ryan, who happens to be in the audience tonight, and I greatly appreciate him coming here. And it really is a pleasure to be here and have a respectful discussion about these important issues, because I have been interested in this debate now, actually not mostly driven by personal interest, but because of the issues around rights and freedoms that exist, and particularly the impact that a change in law might have on religious freedom for more than a decade. In fact, you can go onto my website if you're really interested and find articles written back in about 2008 talking specifically about the challenges around religious freedom should there be a change in law to recognise marriage for same-sex couples. But I'm also a strong advocate for a change in the law for the very simple reason that marriage has an enduring and significant role in our society which we should foster and nurture. Marriage has legal, cultural, religious, and social power, which is incredibly important and advantageous. Words like marriage, husband, and wife mean something in our society. They give a clear delineation and importance to a relationship of deep significance between each other, between individuals. And I think marriage has very strong power that we should seek to encourage around the importance of commitment that two people have to each other to building those relationships with children or without as the foundations for family and then for the rest of the community. In 1994, the Economist newspaper did a cover story, and this was quite leading at the time and radical, which was titled Let Them Wed, which is an argument for same-sex couples to be able to marry on simply economic grounds, not in the way that it's run today, which is economic grounds because there'll be some gain for the wedding industry, but because married people are more mutually dependent on each other, they're more independent as an entity, much less likely to draw welfare benefits, and are mutually supportive in the vulnerable stages of their life, particularly towards the end of their life. And that, in the end, is in many ways what marriage has as a role, particularly for same-sex couples. It continues to have that role, and I think will have an enormously positive contribution towards our society. I also disagree with a lot of the people who say, well, yes, there's some sort of benefit to marriage, but we can create a separate system for same-sex couples that will remove any issues around discrimination. If you want to diminish the standing and importance of marriage in our society, then we should keep creating marriage-like arrangements with all of the benefits, but none of the equivalent obligations that come with marriage. And we do that every time we create civil partnerships, civil registrations, de facto status, as well as, of course, the proposal that many people put up, which is that same-sex couples should be able to have some sort of civil union. I don't think that's a sensible way forward. I think that diminishes marriages and its importance in our society. And I think if we're going to accept a change and support a change, as I would like to see, we need to recognise that it is a significant shift. Often we seem to downplay the idea that allowing same-sex couples to marry is a significant change. It is a significant change. Because 40 years ago, we were assessing the legal standing of same-sex couples' relationships. And the way we were discussing it was whether we threw people in jail or not because of those relationships. Today, we're having a discussion about whether we think, at least in law, they should enjoy the equal protection of heterosexual relationships. And of course, when you're deciding whether people should be thrown in jail or not because of their relationships, you tend not to be debating the legal validity. We're actually going through a significant change for not the first time in human history, but I think you could say an unprecedented extent for the first time in human history, that for the first time, really, we've recognised that same-sex attractive people have a place in society, that their relationship should be legal, and that they should enjoy the same equal protection in law. But I think there are significant challenges for religious freedom that come from this, particularly when religious groups have doctrinal positions. And I think there's a really important discussion that needs to be had about how we preserve the freedom of religious institutions and individuals to act consistent with their faith and their doctrinal positions. But that can only be a conversation that's had if religious people come to the table as part of a discussion around change. Because there are plenty of people, and it's not just on this issue, but it gives a lot of life to through this issue, who have secularist instincts, who want to diminish the standing or the freedom for people to be able to exercise their faith. Now, I'm one of those people who believes that we should have very enlarged respect for religious freedom as part of any change. But at the moment, I feel like sometimes I'm probably one of the few lone voices. Frank's probably another one. There are a couple of us around. The only way that you actually get a proper discussion about how you protect religious freedom and allowing people in law some degree of flexibility, some form of accommodation of people not being forced to act against their conscience, is if we have a proper discussion about the type of change we're going to have. Because Frank's right, there are a lot of people who have said in the past, there are no religious freedom consequences. There are. There are substantial issues that can occur down the track. Because if the state establishes that religion, that marriage means one thing, and doctrinal positions are different, and for instance, because of our hybrid of allowing, for instance, Catholic schools to receive public money attached to teaching the national curriculum, at what point might there be a risk that a religious institution may be compelled to teach something that's in the national curriculum which may run inconsistent with their faith, as one of many examples. Similarly, there are issues about the extent to which people who might hold some form of public office may be compelled to do something that they do not agree with. Now, I think in any of those situations, you need to design laws to make sure that people can act consistent with their faith, but that there's no discrimination against a same-sex couple, and that there's some sort of facilitation to make sure that they do not experience any harm. But again, that comes down to having a respectful discussion about the type of change that we're going to seek to achieve. What I don't think is helpful is having a discussion where everybody retreats, and this comes out particularly with a plebiscite, into their corners, as it were, and the extreme positions. Because I don't think the argument against allowing same-sex couples to marry is winnable. And I don't say that from a position of arrogance or extreme confidence. I say it from a recognition of the human dimension of this discussion. As I said, only in the 1980s did we decriminalise consenting homosexual acts between people in this state, and that was roughly the same time around the rest of the country. And during that time since, all that has occurred is people have recognised, people have come out, been open about their relationships, and people have recognised the common humanity that exists in those relationships. And in order to prosecute successfully the argument against some sort of change, you have to sit in judgment of people's relationships. I don't think Australians are calm about doing that. But everybody knows, and this includes, of course, even within the Australian Catholic University, people who are same-sex attracted. and are in long-term, committed, enduring relationships. In order to win that argument and say they don't enjoy the same protection of law with mainstream Australia, you have to turn my mother against me when it comes down to it, and my father, and my brother, and my sister, and their partners respectively. It is not an argument I think you can win because it is part of a broader societal change. And I don't think it's a constructive way to go forward as a country to have a big public vote on that particular issue and try and engineer that discussion. I think the best way forward is to have these types of respectful conversations and get precisely all the issues out onto the table and then have a discussion about how we can design a law that moves our country forward together.
Thanks, Tim. Our third panellist is Bishop Terry Curtin. Bishop Terry is an auxiliary bishop to the northern region of Melbourne. He's also the Episcopal Vicar for Evangelisation and Mission and chair of the Australian Catholic Bishops Conference Secretariat for Doctrine and Morals. At the time of his appointment last December, he was Episcopal Vicar for Melbourne for the eastern region. It's a welcome home for Bishop Terry because from 1987 to 2002, he was on staff here at ACU and served variously as the chaplain and head of the School of Religion and Philosophy and head of the School of Theology. He has degrees in education from the University of Melbourne and later on a doctorate of theology from the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. He was ordained as a priest for the Archdiocese of Melbourne on the 28th of August, 1971. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in making Bishop Terry welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. You'll have to forgive me a bit if I'm a little bit spaced out. I only returned from overseas on Tuesday. And I also didn't pick up, because the invitation reached me while I was overseas, that the particular focus of this discussion was on same-sex marriage. So my reflections are about the current synod and its addressing family within that marriage. But I'm hoping in what I say that there will be things that would then help in what we've been saying so far. And I also have in the back of my mind that towards the end of this year, the Catholic Church will begin a celebration of the Year of Mercy. So how do those things come and help us? My understanding is that Pope Francis, in calling this synod, and it's already started to meet, synod exists all the time, but to give it this particular topic, was to encourage the Church to look at the beauty and the vital importance of marriage and family, and to do so, to look at it with the look of the Good Shepherd who draws near to each one of us. So the synod is not intended to be something that looks from above and starts from abstract ideas, but with the look of pastors who perceive today's reality in a gospel spirit. Not above all, let this be a critical look set out to underline every lack or what's missing, but a kindly look which sees how much good and how much effort there is even in the midst of times of a lot of suffering. The exercise of the synod is not an academic exercise, but really to go into the middle of the crowd, touch the lives of people, to look for God's presence and action, even in the smallest details of daily life. The challenge that I think the Pope is setting is to believe that, gifted by this courage which comes from the simple nearness, the daily reality of people, we are not distancing ourselves from the Church's teaching. Doctrine, church teaching indeed, is not in the first place a series of abstract declarations, but the light of God's word shown through the apostolic witness at the heart of the church and in the hearts of believers who walk in today's world. The clarity of the light of faith and its doctrinal development in each person is not in contradiction, I understand, with the journey that God undertakes with us ourselves, who are often far from living the gospel fully. Of course, when we enter into this, we need to be aware that for all that the Church holds out, the historical and social dimension of marriage and of the family. Sometimes, I think, as guardians of doctrine, we theologians and bishops forget that human life unfolds in conditions that emerge in society, psychological, social, economical, political, and indeed in historical settings. We could forget that in the course of history, marriage has not always been accessible to all. You know, go back a couple of thousand years, slaves could not marry. there are societies where the payment, marriage required the payment of a dowry, which then ruled out the rural poor and servants of middle-class families. We may have at times watched the TV series Who Do You Think You Are? And discover that celebrities then find that indeed their own family origins are not quite the way they thought they were. Abstract discussions don't help. Maybe at times we talked about many of our young and not so young people today who simply live together in unions without marrying civilly or even less religiously. People can deplore this, or maybe we can ask in a much better way, okay, well, what's changed? Things that happen today, clearly, you know, as Father Frank was saying, and I was talking to a priest friend of mine some time back, and he said, you know, he said, when I fill in the forms for marriage, and I fill in the first one, and then I come to fill in for the second person, when we get to the address, I just say, same address, and on he goes. And in most cases, that is the case. Work is not easy to find, and lasting is in my generation and that of my parents. So how can we expect young people to build a house and establish a family in these circumstances? I was parish priest out at in the North Bourne area, and the properties there were going for millions of dollars. How can one start? I'm not saying this is something good, but you know, we need to behold an attentive and compassionate look at the reality. It's too easy to point the finger and say, oh, there's hedonism, there's the individuality of society, individualism, and that's you know, what is to be put down. It's much more challenging, I think, to observe these realities attentively. We must witness, each of us, to a deep trust in humanity as sons and daughters of God, loved by God, and to a deep trust in marriage and the family, the vital cell of society. Personally, my experience of marriage and family came in the happy and loving marriage of my parents, which ended in my mother's death of cancer when I was 10 and my brother was 8. After her death, my father then lived as a widower for 29 years and 3 days, and he longed to see her again, and that was his increasing hope as death drew near. My brother's first marriage collapsed, but he remarried civilly later on. I was his best man. And he was blessed with a loving marriage and a practicing Catholic faith, which sustained him through 16 years of cancer, where his conviction was that Jesus and Mary were just quietly there helping and guiding him and enabling him in the volunteer work which he took on despite his illness. Indeed, a week before his death, I drove him up to Lifeline on his walking stick, and he was someone who cycled the Sydney to Wollongong bike race, so that he might do his 3 hours of phone counselling with Lifeline. And in his words to me, if I've been able to help just one person, then it's all been worthwhile. In the Second Vatican Council, the Constitution on the Church in Section 8 teaches that this unique Church of Jesus Christ subsists in the Catholic Church. So there's a claim being made there about what the Catholic Church is in relation to what it is that Jesus Christ wished to found. And that church then is described as governed by the successor of Peter and the bishops in union with him. And it goes on to add a further key phrase. Although many elements of sanctification and of truth can be found outside her visible structure, these elements, however, as gifts properly belonging to the Church of Christ, that unique Church of Christ, possess an inner dynamism towards Catholic unity. The Council, therefore, did not take an all or nothing view in its theology of the Church. So, in other words, we don't look, first of all, to see what's missing, but rather what exists positively, seeds of the word, elements of truth and sanctification. Why do I point to that? Because marriage, when considered in the Catholic Church, is seen as the church in miniature, if you like, the family as the domestic church, a little church in itself. And so it seems legitimate to take up that analogy and to say that the sacrament of marriage is fully realised, where rightly there is a sacrament between a man and a woman who live in faith, love and mutual fidelity. But this doesn't mean that there are no elements of marriage, of sanctification of truth, in other forms of marriage and family where this explicit sacramental alliance is lacking or missing. Fidelity, mutual care, the wish to have children are positive elements, They are pending signs of the whole. Civil marriage is something more than just living together. And in civil marriage, it would indicate a greater commitment undertaken in front of society, where the two commit themselves to society and to each other with duties, rights and obligations. To me, it stands closer to sacramental marriage as a sign, as a promise. So instead of speaking of all that's missing, we can approach such realities, noting what is positive in this love, which is stabilising and establishing itself. We should look at the many situations of living together, not only from the point of view of what's lacking, but also what is already promised and already present. The church itself is holy, but it's also made of sinners, and itself walks the path of conversion in the need for forgiveness and purification. A Catholic, therefore, cannot put him or herself on a higher step in relation to others. There are saints in all the Christian churches, and indeed in all other religions. Twice Jesus spoke of the faith of pagans, a woman and a Roman official, and he found their faith to be greater than any that he had found in Israel, a true faith which was found indeed outside the chosen people. If we think this way, then the division is not between those who live a sacramental marriage and the rest of humanity. Those who have the grace and the joy to be able to live sacramental marriage in faith, in humility and mutual forgiveness, with trust in God who acts daily in our lives, I would hope would also know how to look at and see in a couple, de facto, or in a civil union, living in civil marriage, living together, elements of true heroism, of true love, of true self-giving. Not yet a full reality of sacrament, but who are we to say that there are no elements of truth and sanctification there? The Church's role, as I understand it, and Pope Francis is insisting on this, is to accompany each inner growth in a journey. Some, of course, would look for objective criteria when we're talking about inside the Church, an issue that arises there about to what degree of participation can the person who lives in a union that is not a sacramental marriage, can they take part in the Church's sacramental life, which lies at the core of the life of faith? Some would call for the need for pastoral discernment. There has been talk of a penitential practice for couples who are divorced and who married and who seek the sacraments. But where there is a spiritual and pastoral accompaniment of people who walk in this situation, I think we need to distinguish between the all and the nothing. As though you're sacramentally married, therefore it's all there, and if you're not, then there's nothing. I don't think that's the way we can walk. An irregular situation cannot be transformed into a regular one, but there are paths of healing, of deepening, paths in which the law is lived step by step, which could bring the peace to priest who accompanies these people to see that their situation is such that in conscience, his and theirs, he can see their place in the sacramental life of the Church. I think back to my very early years as a priest, and I was at Noble Park, and an elderly couple came to see me, could you come and visit us? And I went round, and it turned out they were from Romania. They were at Mass every Sunday, but never communion. And what emerged was that before the war broke out in Romania, he had been married, and the girl that he married, her family had required, although she lived in the city, that she must marry a boy from the home village. They married. During the time of that marriage, she ran away 3 times. She found it very difficult. War broke out. They got scattered. He ended up, after the war in Austria, in a displaced persons camp. And there he met a Romanian woman who wasn't married. Camp situations are difficult. They could be very vulnerable. But they actually fell in love. I'm not sure what civil arrangement they made, but they then married civilly and emigrated to Australia. Later on, a letter came from Russia, from his wife, the lady that he married, first of all, saying, I'm still alive, I've married again, send money. what then their question was, as we draw close to death, could we come to communion? We would love to come to communion. And I said to them, well, look, and I came out to see them. We talked about it. I said, well, look, we can't go back to pre-war Romania. It's, for me, there were questions already in the freedom to marry, the fact that his wife had been required by her family to marry someone from the village, that she'd run away a couple of times. But to me, there was the evidence of many years of deeply devoted marriage, raising children and grandchildren, their faith that they'd never lost. And I said, if you can say in the sight of God that you are married and that I see in what you are living a sign of Christ's love, because that's what makes it a sacrament, when we see in that that good times and bad, sickness and health, all the days of my life, then I will very happily give you communion. They came forward that Sunday. There was no question of scandal. No one knew the situation. Tears streamed, both theirs and mine. And I didn't feel I was wrong in receiving them to communion on that day. So we try to read the situation and to walk with people in those moments. So then, of course, the problem is when we start to talk with this, people raise the problem of, oh, well, you're just being laissez-faire, just being making decisions lightly. But it would seem to me that while that may and possibly will occur at times, it doesn't cancel out the place for good pastoral accompaniment. The church is a sacrament of salvation, and there is much to explore for the salvation of souls. Christian life, as I understand, is not in the first place a morality, but a friendship, an encounter, a person. In this friendship, we learn how to behave, if we say, and how to respond. If we say, Jesus is our master, it means we learn the ways of Christian life directly from him in a living relationship. Jesus has promised us the Holy Spirit to teach and guide us, remind us of all that he told us. All the church's teaching makes sense only within a living relationship with Jesus, a friendship with him, and an openness to the guidance of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I think in that, and I may finish there, sometimes in discussion, particularly if we are to appreciate what people are living in, whatever their situation is, sometimes the word will be used and some things will be described as intrinsically evil. I don't think that helps that discernment at all. I think it blocks, it doesn't allow us to see what it is that people are living and to look for those elements of truth and sanctification which will enable us to see how is it that God has worked at work with these people in their lives. And perhaps I'll cease at that point.
Thank you, Bishop.
Our final panellist this evening is Miranda Devine. Miranda is one of Australia's leading columnists, currently with the Daily Telegraph and Radio 2GB. She's previously written for the Sydney Morning Herald, the Boston Herald, the London Sun and the London Sunday Times. Miranda was born in New York and grew up mainly in Tokyo and Sydney. She has a Master's in Journalism from Northwestern University in Chicago and a Bachelor of Science in Maths from Macquarie University. Before her career in journalism began, she was a trainee technical officer at the CSIRO Division of Textile Physics, just to show you the diversity of her experiences. Ladies and gentlemen, please make Miranda Devine welcome.
Well, thanks, Julian, and thanks to the ACU for putting this on. It's great to have a respectful discussion on same-sex marriage because, unfortunately, much of what has passed the debate on this issue in recent years has been vicious bullying abuse designed to silence dissent. Those who believe in traditional marriage, especially Christians and other religious believers, have been maligned as hateful bigots and homophobes, the equivalent of racists. They have become moral lepers, people who should not be allowed into the public square. The issue has been presented as an inevitability, linked illogically to tolerance for gay people. Opponents cannot possibly be people of goodwill who are entitled, whether on religious grounds or otherwise, to believe that marriage, as the institution best served to protect children, should remain between one man and one woman. Now, the upshot of this smearing of traditionalists has been not, I believe, a surge in support for same-sex marriage, but a resigned and fearful silence. Few people are willing to die in a ditch to retain the traditional definition of marriage. And the churches are the same as anyone else. They have lost their moral authority in recent years, particularly the Catholic Church, because of the child sexual abuse scandal. So maybe same-sex marriage is as inevitable as the proponents say, but it would be a Pyrrhic victory if it were achieved through intimidation of opponents and fabricated popular support. Rather than enhancing tolerance and freedom, wherever same-sex marriage has been introduced, the opposite has occurred. We've seen extraordinary intolerance, debate suppressed, dissenters monstered, and thought police empowered. For example, the forced resignation of Mozilla's CEO, Brendan Eich, after he was discovered to once have donated $1,000 to a political campaign against same-sex marriage. You had SBS's refusal to run a gentle 30-second advertisement in favour of traditional marriage during its Mardi Gras coverage. We had the compulsory mediation that Toowoomba physician David Van Gend was forced to attend after he wrote an article saying that a baby deserves both a mother and a father. In Tasmania, you have the Catholic Church being sued by a Tasmanian Greens candidate, Martine Delaney, because it sent a pastoral letter to schools explaining why the church upholds the traditional definition of marriage. Just last week in Sydney, you had the New South Wales University Student Rep Council trying to cancel a lecture at Warrane College, which was to be given by former Defence Minister Kevin Andrews, who opposes same-sex marriage. The SRC president there, Billy Bruffy, declared that Mr. Andrews' views do not conform with those of the university or its students, and therefore they shouldn't be heard. In America, we've seen public servant jailed for refusing to marry gay couples, florists, bakers, photographers, celebrants, business people, churches have lost the right not to provide services for a same-sex wedding. Even when the Italian designers Dolce & Gabbana told an Italian magazine the only family is the traditional one, the condemnation was furious and immediate, and Sir Elton John called for a boycott of their clothing. Now, Dolce and Gabbana are gay, so they can hardly be labelled homophobic bigots. Rather than shutting down debate and forcing an outcome by intimidation and exhaustion, Australian same-sex advocates need to make the case for why redefining marriage to disconnect it from children, from the potential procreation and rearing of children, why that would make society better and not worse. It is in everyone's best interest to strengthen marriage as the foundational institution of civil society, in which a man and a woman raise solid citizens, whether they're gay or straight, to replenish the moral capital of the future. And that is where our energies should be focused, rather than on this relentless legislative marriage equality merry-go-round. Marriage is a universal foundational institution which is protected by the law, not created by it. The law simply codified what culture and biology already had created. Nor is marriage owned by any religion. It has underpinned human civilization since the beginning of recorded history. And more than 2,000 years ago, Confucius sang the praises of marriage as the basic foundation of civilization, with its main purpose to cultivate virtue, establish social cohesion and harmony. Marriage has always been the union of one man and one woman for the core purpose of procreating and rearing children. It exists to tame the base sexual instincts of men and women, to harness a mother and father to monogamy, and to encourage potentially procreative conduct within a lasting unit which is optimised for the upbringing of their children. It is not a vehicle just to validate adult romantic interest. Now, I agree with Tim that same-sex partnerships confer a social good and should be equally respected culturally and enjoy equal protection in the law. All civilised people today know that the love of same-sex partnerships is in every sense as valid and important and civilising as heterosexual love, and they deserve equality in terms of the law. And to that effect, in recent years, legislation has been passed to confer all the legal benefits of marriage on de facto partnerships so that same-sex partners are not discriminated against when it comes to superannuation, spousal benefits and so on. And that process, if there is any discrimination, should continue. But it's not been enough. And same-sex marriage activists have created a product and quite brilliantly have marketed it for a decade to create a desire for same-sex marriage, particularly in young gay people. Many older gay people could not think of anything worse than signing up to what used to be regarded as a bourgeois construct. This is not a simple gay-straight dichotomy. In France, when hundreds of thousands of protesters took to the streets to oppose gay marriage and same-sex adoption legislation a couple of years ago, prominent homosexuals led the way. The fact is that rewriting the Marriage Act does not simply extend marriage to worthy new participants. It will transform it. It will replace marriage with a union based simply on sexual romantic companionship. It will weaken an already embattled institution by re-engineering the shared social understanding that shapes it. No one can predict the consequences, but you can see the precedent in no-fault divorce, which weakened marriage by eroding its permanence, profoundly changing the ways families are formed. And the most negative consequence of that was the detachment of fathers from the lives of many children. An institution which was designed to ensure that men took responsibility for their children has been usurped by the welfare state. As a rule, what prevents social chaos and the underclass is an intact family. As a rule, what keeps children safe is an intact family with a father in the home. And of course there are aberrations. You can always find evils within traditional families, domestic violence and child abuse. But even this imperfect institution is better than the Hobbesian social chaos that children of the underclasses, when marriage has ceased to matter, have been born into for the last 40 or 50 years. Unlike Father Brennan, I do not think that the fact that divorce and cohabitation are common is a good argument for further weakening the institution of marriage. In fact, it's the exactly wrong argument. Nor do I think that the fact that other countries have redefined marriage is a good argument for why Australia should follow suit. Marriage is not just a private relationship, it is a social good. Collectively, the erosion of the institution of marriage and the relegating of fathers to the sidelines is destructive to society. You weaken the foundational institution of society, and obviously you end up weakening society. As Paul Kelly pointed out in the companion event in Sydney that ACU ran, we require exhaustive inquiry and consultation over environmental changes, such as a new dam or a new mine. But when it comes to such a profound social change as the redefinition of marriage, we're supposed to just wave it through, allow politicians to just wave it through on the basis of a one-sided media barrage. If same-sex marriage is to happen, it should be by a fair and free vote of the Australian people at a plebiscite. Changing our most important institution deserves no less. And if the polls cited by same-sex marriage proponents are correct, as much as 72% of people in some polls are saying that they are approving of same-sex marriage, then they have nothing to fear. This will settle the debate one way or another, and opponents or proponents will accept that even if they don't get the answer that they want, we live in a democracy and we will all accept it with good grace. Thank you.
We're now going to go to a series of your questions that you'd submitted prior to being here at this debate. But it's also an opportunity for you, if you have been writing away, questions that you'd like to ask our panellists. If you'd like to pass them to the end of the central aisles, we have some people who are coming down the aisles to collect those cards from you, and they'll be presented to us, and we'll have a discussion about that towards the latter half. But maybe for the next 5 or 10 minutes, we'll deal with some of the pre-submitted questions. I might go to Tim Wilson first, coming off from some of the comments that Miranda Devine made. And Miranda gave us a list of some of the erosions of religious liberty that had occurred as a result of the enactment of same-sex marriage around the world, and I know you've been concerned about religious liberty. Given the record of the erosion of religious liberty, how can people of faith expect that actually any of their liberties can actually be protected given the situation in Tasmania now with Archbishop Porteous, given the Victorian government's Victorian Supreme Court's reading down of religious liberty in the Cobourg case, it seems even if you try to protect things legislatively, the protection is illusory.
Well, I think we first need to acknowledge that many of the examples that Miranda provided were of domestic before there's been a change in the law. So it's not as a consequence of same-sex couples being able to marry. It's a consequence of a broader direction in debate. And I think particularly when you look at overseas examples, and I think it's heading in this direction, particularly if we go in a public vote here, is that the tone the day after a change is heavily informed by the tone the day before there's a change. So if we run to a massive conflict as a way of resolving this issue in public discussion, the victor gets to write the rules, essentially. That's how these sorts of things work. Rather than having a proper discussion about how we move the country forward together. And that's one of the reasons why I oppose a plebiscite as much as anything else. I think it's bad for religious freedom. Assuming it is successful, and I think a plebiscite will be successful for the reasons I've argued, I think it will put religious freedom even further on the back foot than it already is. But in the end, a lot of these issues come as a consequence of how laws are designed. The example of Archbishop Porteous in Tasmania, people can rightly complain as they wish about the fact the complaint was made. The issue in the end is the law and the design of the law. And the law gives an incredibly generous opportunity for people to make complaints, to be assessed by the Anti-Discrimination Board about what sexual harassment can mean, which can include people suggesting that some relationships have more value than others. So while we can raise concern about the complaint, in the end, the issue is the law. And that is where the future of religious freedom is in the hands of people of faith and religious institutions. Because once upon a time, religion enjoyed second or third position in terms of authority within our society. That has diminished over time as there's been a rise of people without faith and other sources of authority. And the way to advance discussion around religious freedom has to be as part of a discussion about advancing the freedoms of everybody and having an equal respect for everybody's common humanity while designing laws that have a proper reflection and respect for tolerance of differing points of view. Because if we go into debates such as this with a zero-sum argument, you will get a zero-sum outcome. Whereas if you go in discussing how to advance the liberties and freedoms of everybody, you are more likely to get a change in law that advances the interests of everybody.
Miranda, how well equipped do you think Australia is to have a plebiscite on this? You obviously favour a plebiscite. What do you think the consequences are for the losers of the plebiscite?
I don't think there are any more or less than the consequences of the losers in the debate if it is just waved through by our parliament. I mean, I think that the benefit of a plebiscite in terms of social cohesion is that it gives the imprimatur of democracy to the decision. So what it ends this endless debate. You know, how many times has the issue of same-sex marriage come before our parliament? It keeps on being brought up over and over, you know, with the six-month interim. It will never end until the same-sex marriage proponents get their way. So I think that a plebiscite, even if it is overwhelmingly going to be, even if the opponents of same-sex marriage know that they're going to lose, at least what it does is it just puts to rest the argument and it says the majority of Australians have decided that we want same-sex marriage. That is the way the world is going. That's what Australians want. We will abide by that. Whereas if it's some stitched-up deal by politicians and no one really knows whether that is the will of the people, then there is always going to be residual resentment in the community from opponents.
Frank Brennan, what concerns you about the plebiscite?
Well, two things. One is that I think one of the great things about a conscience vote in Parliament is that it requires our elected representatives to take into account the very complex issues which are relevant to a vote. And I think as a forum of deliberation, I think our Parliament, when it does have a conscience vote, is a pretty good deliberative chamber. And I think that rather than the populism of the plebiscite type thing is a desirable thing. I probably shouldn't name him, but one well-known conservative politician in this country who's a good mate of mine, and I was once with him in that coffee shop there at Parliament House in Canberra. At Aussies. And there were a few politicians sitting around, and he said, you know, it's a good thing to have a conscience vote around here every now and again just to flush people out. And what he was suggesting was that it causes elected representatives to think very deeply about very complex social and moral questions. Now, yes, over against that, have a plebiscite and put it there to the Australian public. I think one problem with a plebiscite, it's a bit like a decision of the US Supreme Court in a strange sort of way. What you get is just a simple yes or no, whereas there's a whole plethora of complex issues that remain to be resolved. Now, if you have the plebiscite where it comes in at a resounding 72%, what then happens in the Senate committee a year later when you're having the conscientious deliberations about all of those complex issues on the side? I think that becomes more difficult. But having said that, we as a country, I mean, sure, we're very democratic in spirit. We Australians like to be asked. I'm not going to get too upset about there being a plebiscite in those terms, but I do think that it has resulted from just the strange Canberra politics that we've had on both sides of the chamber for a while, and I think that's very unfortunate.
Might go... Yes, Bishop Terry.
I actually want to ask a question to Miranda. Given your, you know... voicing of situations where indeed those who wish to speak against same-sex marriage have not been heard in that, would there not be a problem with the plebiscite that the pressure would be such that indeed that lead up to the vote would somehow or other those voices would be prevented from being heard, and therefore how would people be informed to make the choice that their vote would require?
Well, look, I think that debates like this are very important to bring out all the issues and allow people to have a respectful debate, and that is what you would hope would occur before a plebiscite. It would certainly focus people's minds. Those people who had not given any great thought to this issue could, you know, would then be open to listening to other points of view. And look, frankly, it's not all that complicated. And I don't think that there is going to be any more, suppression of people's viewpoints than before before a plebiscite, because more people will realise that there's an opportunity for them to have a voice, and more people will find safe spaces in which to talk. I certainly don't think it would be a negative.
Could I just say, though, just on that issue, I mean, I strongly disagree that there hasn't been the voices against a change in the law being put up in public debate. And I say that because all we're debating is the status quo, the institutions of society that surround us now have created the status quo, and everyone has grown up in that status quo, so everybody knows what the existing law is and the existing position is. So it's not as though it's silent. And there have certainly been plenty of voices who have prosecuted that case and why we should keep that way. But in 1990, there was an opinion poll done by the Institute of Family Studies looking at what people thought about this issue. And that was back before it was in any way fashionable. And 3% of people strongly supported a change in the law, and 11% of people supported. And I can't remember what the number was against, but it was heavily against. All that has happened as we have debated this issue is the case for and the public acceptance for change has grown significantly to the point now where we're saying 72% of people support a change in the law. The continuation of this debate, particularly recognising the intergenerational dimension of it, and there is a big intergenerational dimension to it, is it the case and the degree of support will only increase over time? And there have been plenty of opportunities for people to voice their opposition. It is that in the end, what people have identified is the common humanity that exists between people's relationships. They have respected that common humanity and seen the value in giving it equal protection in law. And the longer we continue to debate it, the more the support will simply increase, no matter how much those who are opposed to change feel they don't feel their arguments have been heard.
Frank.
I'd make a further political point that I think the case for or against a plebiscite is very different now from what it was a month ago. It was one thing to suggest a plebiscite when you had a Prime Minister who had a view different from that of the Leader of the Opposition. What you now have is a Prime Minister of this country who strongly supports same-sex marriage. You have a Leader of the Opposition who strongly supports same-sex marriage. You have the major minor party in the Senate crossbenches, the Greens, strongly supportive of same-sex marriage. For those who are opponents of same-sex marriage, I predict there will be a strong sense of disillusionment which will come into this plebiscite, because it will be seen that the political elite are led by only one side of the case. And I want to add a caution for us as the Catholic Church. I've always had a rule on anything to do with sex in the public square, that a church which is headed by a clergy which is celibate should not say anything much more than those churches that have a married clergy. And I think that the Catholic Church will need to be very careful going into a plebiscite where they know that the Prime Minister, who is Catholic, will be strongly in support of same-sex marriage, that the Leader of the Opposition, who is Catholic, will be strongly in support of same-sex marriage. I think it's going to be a political disaster.
I'm glad you brought us, Frank, to the position of the Church, because there's a few questions from different people about that that I might put to Bishop Terry and yourself. In an age of cultural relativism, aren't people looking for certainty, and wouldn't the Church changing its teaching on marriage weaken the Church? Similar question from the audience today. If the Church has no interest in forcefully promoting its doctrine on marriage, then what's its function? That's on the one side. On the other, I think people understand that the Church doesn't necessarily want to marry two men or two women. But why then does the Church take the position it does for the law more broadly? And I wondered if I might put both those questions to you, Bishop Terry, and you, Father Frank.
Could you please speak up?
Sorry. Sorry. Just to repeat those questions. One on the importance of the Church promoting its traditional position strongly in an age of cultural relativism. And secondly, people having a sense that the Church shouldn't have to marry two men or two women in its own churches and premises, why does it then take a view about what happens in the rest of society?
Well, first of all, we are part of society and therefore we'll have an opinion even on those who take different views to our own, and therefore we would want to voice what it is that we say and have to say as much as they will want to say where they're coming from. And I don't think that the Church could be denied its right to be part of that conversation and discussion, because clearly there's a conviction there after many, many years of the good of sacramental marriage between a man and a woman, loving commitment for life, open to the bearing of children, indeed set as a well, as we said, a domestic church, so a key instrument indeed in the mission of the Church and what it is to do and to be. And of course, in the reflection of that is then the provident love of God for all of us when we look to it being lived in that way. So the Church will not be changing its view on what constitutes sacramental marriage. What I was saying in relation to the Synod and the discussion was, however, that doesn't preclude looking at the realities that people are living to varying degrees. As I said, you know, at times we have taken an all or nothing view. Either you're with us or there's nothing help happening as far as yourselves are concerned. And indeed, you know, part of what one would look for in a pastoral approach would be a recognition of, as I said, elements of truth and sanctification that lie in other ways as people live their lives.
You want to add anything, Frank?
I'd just say two things. One is that, of course, I agree with the Bishop. There's no suggestion here of changing the church teaching on the sacramentality of marriage within the life of the church. But that's a completely different question. What should be the law in a pluralistic democratic society where most of the people in that society do not adhere to that view about the theological notion of marriage, and most of the marriages in that society are not viewed by the Catholic Church as being sacramental marriages recognised by the Church. The second point I'd make is that if we were to have this meeting in 100 years' time, it may be that there's no change to the Church's teaching on marriage, but I would be prepared to speculate there will be a significant change in the Church's teaching on sex and sexuality. Now, on this, the Catholic Church is playing catch-up and will continue to do so for some time. And ultimately, the decisions will be made by those of coming generations about what it is to express one's sexuality, seeing oneself created in the image and likeness of God. Now, at the moment, I think the Catholic Church is in something of a cul-de-sac, which culminated in the 1968 encyclical on birth control, and we are still living the sociological reality where most Catholics from that time forward, particularly in countries like Australia, have basically said, well, that's the teaching of the group of celibate men, but it's not the way we live our lives. Now, ultimately, over the next century, there will be a need for the Catholic Church to get a greater symmetry between that which is given as dogma in terms of teaching about sexuality and that which is the practice of people who live good, conscientious and loving lives.
A question now to Tim Wilson about the rights protection. If same-sex marriage comes into law, how do you propose that the rights of the church will be protected?
Well, I've written quite an extensive article about this in the Australian, or the Weekend Australian, a few months ago, and I don't want to labour through every component of it, but I think it comes back to one of the points I was making before. When we look at marriage, we all have different views about what the institution of marriage is. Obviously, if people come from a doctrinal position, whether it's this faith or another faith, it has a very important and significant religious component to it. And that is an entirely legitimate way to look at it. Nobody has a monopoly on the institution. Whereas if you come, like I do, I'm an utterly irreligious person, it has primarily a personal and a civil responsibility. And I think one of the key ways that we can do it is recognise that we have this institution, but that it serves multiple purposes. And what I've gone through in my writings in the past is to argue that we should separate them out in law and recognise there's a thing called civil marriage. And then there's something called, whether it's religious marriage or conscience marriage or something akin to that, that has a slightly different purpose for people, but treat them equally in law. And then off the structures of that, you can set up ways to make sure that particularly religious institutions are always acting consistent with the law, because the law says there is a thing called religious marriage. Then you can design protections which facilitate and accommodate religious freedom for individuals so that they're not compelled to act against their conscience. But by making sure that as part of that facilitation that there's no harm to them, that they also do no harm to others. Now, of course, law is never perfectly settled, and there will be people at some point in the future who will have a disagreement with that structure and want some other type of change. And we have that as part of an ongoing debate, for instance, around anti-discrimination law, where there's significant exemptions for religious institutions and individuals. But there's a big difference between protections that exist in law for religious freedom, for institutions which are vague or are designed to be very generous to institutions, and ones that are designed specifically to ensure that people aren't forced to act against their conscience. Because we can all understand why at some point we may not want to be forced to act against our conscience. And where those exist, and where they can be facilitated in law, so long as they do no harm to others, I struggle to see in Australia now or into the future where people would want to see those things changed. But again, I come back to the central point. The only way that you can have a discussion about what those are, how they operate, is for those who have a religious conviction on this issue and, in fact, who disagree with the change in the law but want to see the preservation of religious liberty through discussion have to be part of the discussion rather than just using religious freedom as a justification not to see any change at all.
I want to bring in the issue of children here because we've had quite a few questions on children and things about the Convention on the Rights of the Child and the importance of children to have both male and female role models in terms of a mother and a father and to know their biological parents, an issue that Frank Brennan raised. I wondered if I might ask each member of the panel their views on the role of children in this particular debate. I might start with Miranda.
Well, really, I mean, what I said, obviously... same-sex parents have been, you know, I know several who are fantastic parents, and so there is nothing about same-sex partnerships that makes them makes the people to be less good parents, and in a lot of cases, better parents. But it's not about the particular; it's about the general. It's about the institution. It's about having it's about having something to aspire to. And I think where, again, I disagree with Father Brennan, that, you know, the church, we're all sinners. You know, nobody is perfect. But the whole idea of having, I guess, rules or church edicts or to have aspirational values is that we all aspire to that. So while people might be living, might be cohabiting, or they might be divorcing. If there is no greater kind of ideal of marriage, then what is there to aspire to? It's like children. You set boundaries for them. If there are no boundaries, they they are not safe and protected. And I just think that of all places, the churches should be, even if your flock is ignoring you, you need to stand up for what the church teachings are. And, of course there are non-ideal, terrible, abusive relationships within traditional marriage. There are aberrations all over the place. But the ideal is... and what marriage has always been for time immemorial is it is a place where adults, male and female, are harnessed in this unit for procreative purposes to give the safest and best, most optimal environment for children. And, nothing changes that. You can have all sorts of fantastic relationships outside that, but in general, that is the case.
Bishop Terry?
Yeah. I'd like to build on what Miranda was saying, and one of the things to be said is that the Catholic Church's approach to children is it comes out of the Gospel, where Jesus says, the kingdom of God belongs to such as these, and the small child is placed before them. And, of course, the Catholic Church's practice has been to baptise children. It's so important for us to have children as members of our community, so that without their presence and indeed their participation, the church is not fully what it is to be. In the raising of children, then, because of their importance, we would, value that whole sense of human identity that lies in the complementarity of male and female. And that would be my question put to same-sex partnerships. How then does the child come to that sense of both male and female dimensions in life, and then finding their own place in relation to that?
Tim?
Well, I think the last part of the Bishop's comments and the question is an entirely good one, because it's one that doesn't just face same-sex couples, it's one that faces children of same-sex couples, it's of course children of single-parent households who face that same challenge. And that's where, in the end, it doesn't come down simply to the immediate structure. We know full well that the only role models in children's lives aren't their parents. There's other family members. There's community people. But equally, that everybody has a contribution and a role to play. so it's not isolated to this discussion. The role of children in this discussion is incredibly important because there are children, of course, who have same-sex parents. And they too should have parents, in my view, who are in stable, committed relationships. And the way we have expressed that traditionally as a society is through marriage. Now, the Australian law, including in the wording that civil celebrants are legally required to say at a marriage ceremony, never mentions children. I'm not saying that marriage doesn't have a dimension around children. It historically does, but it is not the sole determinant of it. A large part of the discussion is about commitment, about a union of people for life, which, to be honest, we've become very poor at respecting. So children play an enormous part of it. And there is a flow-on discussion, though it's not an immediate correlated relationship, around broader issues in our society that affect heterosexual and homosexual people alike, around issues like surrogacy. They don't follow automatically from a discussion around marriage. In fact, to be honest, our society has looked at discussions like surrogacy and IVF and everything else and largely turned a blind eye to it. And I think that's enormously problematic. I think we need to have a really intelligent, robust discussion about these issues because to the extent that there is any harm that is caused from any type of relationship in the way children are brought into the world through mothers and fathers engaging in sexual activity, all the consequences are borne by children because we send people overseas, outside of the sphere in which we can have influence or regulate what is in the best interest of the child and of the surrogate, rather than having a mature and respectful discussion in our country where we put the interest of the child and the surrogate first. But that is not the same discussion or doesn't automatically flow from marriage, but it's a much broader discussion about the changing nature and structure of families in our society.
Frank, I'll give you the last word on...
I'd consider three groups of children. First, those children who are being brought up and nurtured now by same-sex couples. Then I think the state has an obligation to try and enhance the prospects of those children within those family units. And I think the Catholic Church, for example, should provide education services to those children just as they would to children from other family units. Second, in terms of adoption, I would say that where you are dealing with the adoption of a child who is not related to either of the couple, then when it comes to the limited number of those children who are available for adoption, I think it is still essential that one should act in the best interests of the child. And in circumstances where, now I know it's difficult to assess these things, but if it could be said that all things being equal, I think an adoption agency should still have an entitlement to show a preference for placing that child for adoption with a couple constituted by a man and a woman, in terms of that being in the best interests of the nurturing of that child within the sort of society of which we're a part. And the third would be the issue in terms of the development of assisted reproductive technology. I would continue to espouse what has been there in Catholic thinking for a long time, but also in the whole natural law tradition, the idea which all of us carry that each of us, no matter what the complexity of our own background and family arrangements, we all know we have one biological mother and one biological father. Now, I think we interfere with that, even in the names of giving a same-sex couple the capacity to create a child with only their own genetic inheritance. I think existentially that's an enormous step for humanity, and I would caution strongly against it.
Well, thank you very much. Would you please join me in thanking all of our panellists this evening?